His hand. My name is written on His heart. I know that while in heaven He stands, no tongue can really fence depart. No tongue can really fence depart.
Despair and tells me of the guilt within, of what I look and see Him there, who made an end of all my sins.
Sin the Savior,
because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on Him and pardon me. To look on Him and pardon me. I am a strong and perfect king. My God has ransomed me.
Jesus the Savior.
Jesus the Savior. One with Himself, I cannot die. My soul is purchased by His blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior.
Welcome everyone as we gather online to worship God. But as we do so, we're continually reminded of the ravages wrought by the pandemic, and we think especially of the desperate plight of millions of people in India. What can we do to help? Well, of course we can pray, because we know a God who hears and answers prayer, but we can also give. And we're suggesting giving through a charity which has local links here in Worthing called Amen. And Amen supports various projects, Christian projects in India, and they're working very hard during this time of pandemic. And I can guarantee, having visited these projects on a number of occasions, that every pound that we give without any deductions for salaries here in the UK or publicity or administration, every penny of every pound will go to these different ministries for them to use on the ground in the most effective and direct ways to the poorest of the poor there in India. So if you would like to give, then at the end of the service there'll be the details of how you can do that, and I trust God will move your heart to give generously. But why don't we pray about this situation right now? Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the resources entrusted to us in this country. We thank you for the fact that so many of us have received vaccinations. Some of us have received hospital treatment. We've had help from all kinds of directions in all kinds of ways. But we recognize that what's true here is not true in many different countries, including India. And Lord, we want to pray for all of those who are seeking to meet the needs with limited resources, whether they are working in hospitals or in the grounds of local communities. Wherever they are, Lord, we pray that you would help them and that they might have all the resources that they need to get the job done. We particularly pray for Christian workers and pastors who are going to the poorest places and risking their own lives to express the love of Jesus and to give relief to those who are suffering from this pandemic. Lord, touch our hearts, move our hearts, that we might be generous in meeting the needs of those that we might not meet in this life, but perhaps one day we'll have the joy of meeting them in the next, to discover that something that we did, something that we gave, something that was said to them in the name of Jesus, brought them into your wonderful forever family. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, later in the service, we're going to hear from Steve Jennings. Now, I like introducing my friends to you in these services, and Steve is another of those friends. He's been an elder of a local church, and he's also a very good central heating engineer. So if any time you've got problems with your boiler, or if you think your boiler would appreciate a service in the summer, then Steve's your man. I can recommend him to you. But of course, he's here today, not for that kind of service, but for this service where we're worshiping God together. And he has a message from the Lord for us. And with that message, he's sharing his story of how, in a remarkable way, from a surprising background and in interesting circumstances, he became a follower of the Lord Jesus, a committed Christian. You're going to be inspired by what Steve shares with you, and you may well want to ask him some questions or follow up on the story he tells later on. But before that, we're going to worship together. I remember how the psalmist said, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth." It's always right and appropriate to give our praise and worship to God. And that's why we're going to begin with the song, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness." So let's celebrate the goodness of God expressed in the wonderful gift of the Lord Jesus in his life and death and resurrection. Sing it along with me if you can.
Blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not. trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. The storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the same. Righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne.
Father God, as we come to you in prayer, there are many issues on our hearts and minds that we would bring to you in these troubled times. But we also have much to be thankful for, so we want to come with a thankful heart. Thank you that you are the same God today as you were pre-pandemic, and we can trust you in the same way, even in troubled times, as we can when things are good. You are a faithful God, cares for each and every one of us and wants to be involved in the detail of our daily life. So as we pray, would you bring a peace into our hearts and a reassurance that our future is secure in your hands. So we pray for our country. We give thanks for the amazing rollout of vaccine and the reduced number of infections and deaths. We pray this would continue. We pray particularly for NHS staff as the reality of the past months hit home. We pray for their mental well-being. Would we bring them a peace that can only come from you? We pray for the future as we begin to come out of lockdown. As many clamour for freedom, we pray for a spirit of selflessness, that people would put others before themselves. We pray that all the initiatives that have begun to help others in need will continue and flourish, and not disappear as we get back to a more normal life. We continue to ask that you would give wisdom to our government and all those in authority that make decisions at this time. And we pray that many would turn to you as the only way to have real security in the future. And Lord, as we give thanks for the slowing of the pandemic in the UK, we pray for other countries. We pray specifically for India and Brazil, where the virus is accelerating. We pray for those in authority that they would find the resources to do everything possible to contain this virus. We pray for those dealing with the daily infections and death. Lord, would you give them peace of mind and a strength beyond their own to cope with this situation? And we pray for those, many that mourn, that you would bring comfort at this time. Lord, we give thanks for all those involved in the development and production of vaccines. We pray that ways would be found to increase production to enable the whole world to have access readily, that there will be a fair distribution throughout the world. We pray specifically for the continued development to eliminate any side effects of the vaccine and to control any future mutations of the virus. Then lastly, Lord, we pray for ourselves as your church, as we begin to work out how we can once again meet to worship you, to fellowship with each other, and start the various activities within the church. Lord, we pray for fresh vision of how we can serve you and the community of Findon Valley. We pray you would inspire us afresh in the activities we offer that allow us to share your love with those in the community around us. Lord, we look to you to lead us afresh into the future, whatever that holds. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
The reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning at verse 11, to chapter 6, verse 12. The Ministry of Reconciliation. Since then we know what it is to fear the Lord. We try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. We are not trying to commend ourselves to you again, but are giving you an opportunity to take pride in us, so that you can answer those who take pride in what is seen rather than what is in the heart. If we are out of our mind, as some say, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died, and he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As God's fellow workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain, for he says, in the time of my favour I heard you, and in the day of salvation I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favour, now is the day of salvation. We put no stumbling blocks in anyone's path, so that our ministry will not be discredited. Rather, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, in great endurance, in troubles, hardships and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience and kindness, in the Holy Spirit and in sincere love, in truthful speech and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonour, bad report and good report, genuine yet regarded as impostors, known yet regarded as unknown, dying and yet we live on, beaten and yet not killed, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor yet making many rich, having nothing and yet possessing everything. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians, and opened wide our hearts to you. We are not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Steve, and I'm saying morning. It's morning for me as I'm doing this recording. For you, it probably is morning. But good to be, and thank you to be here, and thank you for inviting me to speak this morning. I want to speak about something that is it's a message for us, but it's also a bit of a personal testimony as well, incorporated in that. And I want to talk about something which is so often overlooked and even totally missed in a religious world, and yet it is something that is so fundamental and so often repeated in scripture. And I want to say that because I am a person that was very, very religious. For the first 40 years of my life, I was extremely religious, and yet I overlooked something that was so fundamental to the Christian faith. I want to turn to John 3 and just read a few verses from John 3. I'm sure many of us, if not all of us, have read this many times. It says there was a man named Nicodemus, a Jewish religious leader, who was a Pharisee, a very respectable religious man, by all accounts. After dark one evening, he came to speak with Jesus. "Rabbi," he said, "we all know that God has sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you." Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus obviously replied, "What do you mean?" exclaimed Nicodemus. "How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again?" Jesus replied, "I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and of the Spirit." Nicodemus was a very religious man, so was I. And yet, quite naturally, in his humanness, he's thinking, what does that mean? Can a man enter his mother's womb and be born again? Just didn't get it. But of course, as Christians, we know that this is so fundamental, this new birth, which is so often repeated in scripture, and which is so central to the Christian faith. And so what I want to do is just talk to you about my life, or my testimony. I was a Jehovah's Witness for many, many, many years. I'm a fifth generation Jehovah's Witness, or was. My grandparents were witnesses, my parents were witnesses, my brother and I were witnesses, my brother still is, our children and my adult children still are. My mum is, my brother and his children and his children's children. I think there are five generations going on there. And my brother and I were brought up in the religion or the organisation of the Jehovah's Witnesses. And when we were kids, it was hard. It was hard being a witness child. We were the ones that couldn't go into religious assembly at school. We couldn't celebrate birthdays. We didn't celebrate Christmas. We didn't celebrate quite a lot, actually. We didn't celebrate very much at all. And yet, we tried to fit in with our friends the best we could at school, but it was difficult. It was very difficult because we weren't really allowed to make friendships outside of the organisation. And I think, just looking back, one of the most difficult things about being part of that organisation was the door-to-door ministry. I've literally spent thousands of hours knocking on people's doors. Yes, I'm the annoying person that knocks on your door on a Saturday morning, or used to be, and to talk to you about the Bible. And as children, that was hard. Me and my brother used to really find that very difficult. We were always in fear. I remember always being in fear of calling on someone's door, and it be a school friend, or even worse, a school teacher, which often, well, not often, but it did happen. And it was very difficult. I remember one weekend worrying, thinking, what if the teacher humiliates me in front of the class because we knocked on her door at the weekend? Fortunately, she didn't actually, but even so, something quite humorous about it is we would do anything to get out of the door-to-door work. And by and large, the witnesses do find it difficult. But my brother and I, we were up in Yorkshire. Forgive the accent, I am Yorkshire. It's not a speech impediment. we were up in Yorkshire. It was a very, very cold winter. And my mum knitted us some balaclavas. Knocking on people's doors with balaclavas, you wouldn't get away with it now. But we're just young children, and they were horrible things. They used to itch round here. You just wanted to rip them off. However, we soon found that there was a hidden benefit to these balaclavas, because no one could recognise us. And my brother and I were walking along the road, and my brother said, "I've just seen one of my mates at school, and he didn't recognise me." He said, "These are fantastic," even though they drove us mad. And so we wore them all the way through February, March, April, May, June, July, August. And my mum realised, obviously, that we were using them for a reason. So yes, it was difficult being a witness, but that's how we grew up. 3 meetings a week, and also at regular field service and studying the publications and so on. And then, like with all faiths, there comes a time when you get to a certain age where you have to make a decision. As a child, I had no choice. My brother and I had no choice as to whether we were part of the organisation. But when you get to adulthood, you have to make that choice, and you have to say, well, yes, I am going to make this my faith, or no, I'm going to walk away from it. And both my brother and I accepted the faith for ourselves and got baptised into the organisation, which is a point in itself. You get baptised into the organisation, which is a little bit odd, with great repercussions if you decide to leave from there onward. And so my brother and I, we progressed in the organisation. We both served as elders, and my brother served as what you would call the minister of the local church or the Kingdom Hall. And we really embraced it, so much so that we began to bring our children up in the faith. And we inculcated the things that had been indoctrinated in us into them. And I have to say, my children, I've got 2 boys, and they're adults now, and they're both very, very much involved in the organisation. So many people ask at this stage, well, why would you leave? How come you would leave? And the answer is, it's not a short answer, but what happened was, I found it very hard being a witness as an adult as well, because it is a works-based faith, contrary to scripture, and you have to keep on and on working, almost on a treadmill of existence, in order to earn your salvation. And that is hard. That becomes quite burdensome. And so as time went on, I got weary with it. And in my marriage at the time, I was experiencing difficulties. And so I stepped down from being an elder in the organisation. And I now began to just think about, what is this faith that is driving me so into despair? Because I just cannot match what they're demanding that I need to do in order to be able to be saved. And so what I did at that particular time was step back and start to read scripture independent of the watchtower. because they call it a Bible study, but really it's a Watchtower publication study with selected scripture thrown in. And during this time, my marriage began to fall apart. And ultimately, just stepping back from the organisation meant that I did get involved in a sinful way of life, certainly not a way of life that would be becoming of a Christian. And so I fell into sin, and ultimately I was disfellowshipped before a panel, a judicial committee, as the witnesses call them, three elders that interviewed me, and they chose to disfellowship me. They made that decision because of the sinful life that I was leading. Now, I'd been on the other side. I'd been one of the elders on the judicial committee, disfellowship on others in the past, but now I was on the receiving end of that. And so when you're a witness, that is no small deal to be disfellowshipped. This shunning practice that they have is hard for, I really feel for anyone that has been disfellowshipped from the organisation, because basically your whole community, your family, the closest family members, your spouse, your children, your parents, my brother, you're not able to talk to them. From that moment on, all communication is has ceased until you decide to come back into the organisation. That's what they're instructed to do, and they will be disciplined if they don't hold to that standard that they set. And so I now began to think about, what do I do? I remember getting in the Kingdom Hall car park immediately after I'd been disfellowshipped, and I put my head down in the car, and I thought, what do I do? My whole world has just evaporated in one decision. I've no one to talk to. I've no one I can phone or... And I do remember, and this is a good point to remember, I do remember years ago, prior to that, I was on the door-to-door service, and I spoke to, they normally go in pairs, and I was leading this field service arrangement, as they call it, and I knocked on the door of a lady, and she said, I was working on my own that day, because it was an odd number, and she says, oh, I'm a born-again Christian, thank you. And I thought, oh, here we go, you know, met born again Christians before. And we had a scriptural discussion, more of a debate really, on the Trinity doctrine. And so it went on, and I thought, oh yeah, I've got the upper hand here, because the witnesses are very well versed in using certain scripture to make certain doctrinal points that agree with their theology. And but then just before I left, she says, can I just say something to you? And I said, yeah, of course you can. She said, well, the thing is, she says, I told you I'm a born again Christian, and my husband has had an incurable eye disease, and he's received a lot of prayer recently, and he's just been back to the medics, and they've said that there's no trace of this eye disease. And I thought, whoa, for a witness, that is just off my radar. I'm thinking, I don't know what to do with that, because witnesses are cessationists. They don't believe that these things, the gifts of the Spirit, exist now. And so I just thought, I don't know what to do with that. And she also said, can I just tell you about myself a little bit? I said, well, yeah, by all means. And she said, well, the thing is, she says, I've not always been a Christian, but when I became a Christian, I became born again. And she said, I was changed from the inside out. Something happened to me. I was filled with the Holy Spirit of God, and something on the inside changed, and it's changed how I am on the outside. And I had no answers for this. I didn't know what to do about this. So basically, we said goodbye, and I went back to the car. I couldn't do any more door-to-door ministry that morning. I just could not do any more. So I went back to my car, and I sat down in the car, and I remember thinking, what on earth do I do with that? That lady's got something that I haven't got. That lady's got something that I don't see in the Kingdom Hall that I attend. I don't see it among my fellow witnesses. But I kept it to myself. I was an elder at the time, and it's not healthy to be to be doubting the organisation. And so I kept it to myself. But the moment, years later, when I was disfellowshipped, I thought about that. And I thought, there must be something out there. There must be. And so that was a tremendous comfort. And I thought of Romans, where Jesus says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And nothing will separate my love from you. And he goes to great lengths, does he? The Apostle Paul, he says, neither height, nor depth, nor any other creation, angels, anything on earth, anything in heaven, nothing will separate my love for you. No group of men on a judicial committee is going to separate my love for you. I still love you. And that was tremendous comfort. And there was something taking place in the spiritual realm. And so I thought, oh, praise you, God, I can do something, even though the organization has rejected me. And so time went on, and I then began to discover scripture for what scripture is, independent of what's our organization. And long story short, I became a born-again Christian. And that's why I said about with Nicodemus. Nicodemus was extremely hard-working, probably honourable, religious man, but had no idea about being born again until Jesus pointed it out. And I had no idea about being born again. In fact, the witnesses don't allow you to be born again. They say that the number of born-again Christians was filled with 144,000 many, many years ago. And so now you are of the other sheep and you're not to be born again. Interestingly, when they do the communion, once a year they do it at Easter time, communion, the bread and the wine is there and it's passed up and down the rows as people are sat there. But nobody partakes of the bread and the wine. You're forbidden to partake of the bread and the wine. Because it, just bear with me while I turn my phone off. Yeah, forbidden to partake of the bread and the wine because you're not born again. That number has been filled by witnesses many, many years ago. And that reminded me of a scripture which is in Matthew 23, verse 13, where it says, what sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You won't go in yourselves and you don't let others enter either. And I began to realize I have been taught that it's wrong for me to be born again. They're not born again. And they prevent others from being born again by imposing that doctrine. And so as time went on, I began to realize that there was more out there. And I did actually become a born-again Christian. Praise God. What's the upshot of that? Tremendous. Whereas before, I was trying by works to be a good person. I was trying to change myself from the outside in. And now I'm changed from the inside out. I'm finding that being born again Christian is a delight. I'm no longer on the treadmill. Jesus' load is light. Come under my yoke. It's not burdensome. And so that was about 15 years ago. So now you can work out my age. And I'm a little bit more on top of that, a bit more than 15 years ago, that I became a born-again Christian. And that has proved to be a significant change in my life. I am now truly a child of God. Scriptures like Titus 3 verse 5 came alive, where it says, He, God, generously poured out the Spirit upon us through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Because of his grace, he made us right in his sight and gave us confidence that we will inherit eternal life. Praise God. Another wonderful scripture that just shows how light this burden is. Oh, it's not a burden. How light this load is that we have once we're born again believers. It says, God saved you by his grace. This is Ephesians 2, verse 8, God saved you by his grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for good things we have done. So none of us can boast about it, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do the good things he has planned for us long ago. Amen. I also want to say that I have absolutely no resentment, anger, or animosity to the witnesses. When I was part of the organisation, I was sincere. I was sincerely wrong and misled, but I was sincere. And I saw that in fellow witnesses. And my heart goes out to them. I've learned a lesson that actually that lady that spoke to me when I knocked on her door, we don't need to be ridiculing them. We don't need to be arguing with them. We need to accept the fact that they need the kingdom. They need to be born again like anyone else. And the fact that that lady spoke to me, it stayed with me. And I think that's a lesson for all of us. We have to be careful when we are speaking to them. I know Graham has had many encounters with them, because they use selected scriptures to try to twist the theology of Christianity. So we do have to be careful, but at the same time, we have to be loving, kind, and try to reach out to their heart. And my recommendation would be, tell them your testimony. When that lady told me her testimony, it had such a tremendous impact. And all of us can do that. All of us can do that. And so I just want to finish off with this scripture. It's in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 18. It said, and all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. And all this is a gift from God. And that is a wonderful thing. And I think for Christians as well, or for religious people, it is good to remember that unless we are born again, we will not, no matter how disciplined we are, no, it doesn't matter how hard we try, we cannot become a child of God by earning it. It has to be something, that miraculous thing that takes place when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Saviour. We become born again, and then we begin to see that the good works are just almost a byproduct of that, because the heart has changed from the inside out. And so I just wanted to relate that this morning. Hope it's been beneficial. Usually in this situation, it means that a lot of people have got a lot of questions to ask, and I'm always available. Graham's got my contact number. If you're no witnesses, or if you're interested in becoming a witness, or whoever hears this, or you're trying to assist them, I'm always here to help. So God bless you. Thank you so much for hearing me this morning. It was a bit garbled. It's quite early in the morning, but nevertheless, hopefully it's beneficial. God bless.
Grace. slaves. I have already come. Disgrace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me
Thanks so much, Steve, for sharing your story of how you left the Watchtower Society to commit your life to Jesus Christ. And as you talked about how you were disfellowshipped, being completely cut off, not only from your friends, but even from your closest family, I was reminded of a couple of things that the Lord Jesus said. One of them was that he said, a man's enemies could be those of his own household, that your nearest and dearest might hate you because of Christ. And I can't imagine how hard it must be to know that you're separated, estranged from your closest family, and that unless they're rescued from the Watchtower Society, you will never realistically see them or have a relationship with them in this life or in the life to come. But I also know that you've discovered the truth of Jesus' promise in Mark chapter 10, that there will be no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands, Jesus said, for my sake and the gospel, who will not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses, brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions and in the age to come, eternal life. Because God is no man's debtor, and he will make up to you all that you've lost and give you so much more besides. Now, Steve mentioned, folks, that if you've been involved with the Watchtower Society or you've got questions or concerns about the issues that Steve has been talking about, he'd be very happy to chat with you. So do contact him. His email will appear in the notices at the end of this service, but I'll give it to you right now. In any case, it's sjenningsgas@hotmail.co.uk. sjenningsgas@hotmail.co.uk. That's also to contact him if you want some help with your central heating system. That's the email address to use. And now I want to say to everyone who's watching and listening, if you're wanting to know peace with God, if you want to have the same assurance that Steve has, then this final song I've chosen just for you. And as you listen to the song, I'd encourage you to reach out to God, say yes to Jesus in your heart, and know that God will meet you where you are and begin to change you from the inside out. The song simply says, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Hear him calling to you right now. And may God bless you and give you an assurance of his love for you in the days that lie ahead. Hope to see you again very soon.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me.
Tenderly, Jesus is calling.